So today I have here with me Nishtha Satyam, who is the country representative of Timor-Leste at UN Women. Thank you, Nishtha, for having me here. I'm so glad to share this platform with you to address this critical issue and collectively join hands to help stop the spread of any form of violence against women on this very important day.
Thank you very much, Shraddha. It's in fact a pleasure that you've taken time, very busy schedule, to be with us here. And I just want to reiterate the importance of using voices like yours that reach out to a million followers online, offline, that influence people in their daily choices in a way that doesn't threaten them, in a way that is encouraging, in a way that is soft. An absolute privilege and honor for me to be with you on this platform. So Shraddha, all of us, including me, are very trained to identify the physical abuse because it's so visible. You can see the bruise, you can see the tears, you can see the sorrow. But we kind of do not recognize other forms of violence like emotional violence, financial violence, control, surveillance, verbal abuse. How do you think we can bring attention to different kinds of violence in different kinds of spaces, so that we don't invisibilize the women that go through them?
I think it's so important for people, and this is women, children, men, everybody to know that violence is just not physical. We connote violence primarily, it's physical violence. If you see something, it's physical violence. But it can also be emotional, it can be economic, it's psychological or even sexual. And women face violence by being subjected to even child marriage, human trafficking, or even female genital mutilation. So, and comparing between any of these is impossible because some of these forms, as you said, some of these forms of violence, they don't leave any visible signs due to which they can go completely unnoticed for several years. And they can affect the victim physically, emotionally, psychologically at various levels for years to come. So discuss and talk about these forms of violence to spread awareness about the forms of violence and recognize that when they're being exposed to it, there is strong action that's taken against it.
I think the first step in something like this would be to acknowledge before we respond. I think we're still in that phase where we're training our minds and hearts really to see through something that's not physical, just not out there. So I completely agree with you.
You know, Nishtha, what I'm so glad we're doing this because I feel like in whatever way we can, or rather I can use my platform to spread more awareness. Thank you for giving me this opportunity. And I wanted to ask you, so what are the kind of steps that you think we can take as a society to ensure that the normalization of any kind of violence is avoided?
Before we identify how do we not normalize this, is to identify how we normalize it. So if we were to denormalize this, if we were to treat this with the seriousness and the criminality of length that it has, we absolutely must first put up our hands when it's just sliding in there, right? And I have so many of these WhatsApp jokes where this introduction line says, once a man was beating up his wife, and then there's an entire joke that follows, right? And we've all read them. We've all been party to them. But we've never noticed that there is such a fundamental violation of rights in the first line itself. We are in some ways consuming content which is telling us this is okay. Our heart feels this is business as usual. So when we work on the ground, when we go back, the most part of our work on violence takes us convincing the woman and helping her understand and acknowledge that this is not how life is supposed to be. This is not business as usual. You don't have to go through this because you're a woman and it's not okay. The second, of course, to work on the higher rung, which is to work with law enforcement, etc. It's the whole rung of people that are first responders in a situation like
that. I hope that this really starts stimulating a conversation to begin with. It's so important for people to know that you're to protect yourself is above all of this. It's above all the taboos and the labels that, you know, unfortunately we've all grown up seeing around us. You know, it's you protecting yourself needs to be above everything. You know, to normalize speaking up and making an issue out of it because it is an issue.
Let me ask you a question as someone who comes from an industry that's very different from mine. And I think we're having a conversation as two young women from different worlds, really. How safe do you think women are? What is your experience, really, of issues of gender?
Since we're talking about this, and, you know, it just baffles me how when I hear someone sharing a story about, you know, oh no, he just abused me. He didn't hit me. He only abused me. He only verbally said something bad to me. He verbally said something terribly horrible to that person. And this person is justifying that, oh, it was not a physical act of violence. It was an abuse, so it's okay. So, you know, it's baffling because, again, it boils down to socio-cultural upbringing. It boils down to also, you know, I think a lot of women feeling that if they don't speak up, what will happen? Will they be able to financially support themselves, or will they be okay without their partners and with the divorce tag, or with, you know, what will people say? How log kya kahenge aur phir mera kya hoga? But aapka kya hoga agar aap is relationship mein aur rahoge, you know, aapki zindagi ka kya hoga, aapke mansik health ka kya hoga, what will happen to you as a person? You will completely destroy yourself as a person. And you know, it baffles me that people are okay with that, because it's so sad. It's just heartbreaking, because as a society, as a collective entity, we need to support these victims and support the survivors and be like, you know, good that you spoke up. That's exactly what you need to be doing, because what you're enduring is wrong and that should not be happening in the first place. It's very, very prevalent around, and I really, really hope that, you know, this conversation just helps people to speak up, and people should know that physical violence is not the only kind of violence that is wrong. If someone speaks to you badly, if someone is trying to psychologically manipulate you in your workplace or in some kind of interaction to get something out of you and make you feel threatened in a way where you feel genuinely helpless, let it out, because that's the way it needs to be. And no one needs to be enduring this at all. Bring this issue to light, because no one should experience this kind of distress ever. And we should definitely be supporting survivors, strengthening services for them, teaching the younger generation about respectful relationships, focusing on early education. And it's not about just women. It's about women, men, girls, boys, society as a whole. I would like to ask you something as well, that violence can affect an individual both physically and mentally. What do you say, Nishtha, and what ways can one support a victim in this vulnerable situation?
So first is to culturally and collectively get over the understanding that if there is a violation of rights, anybody's, man or woman, as a citizen of this country, it is our moral responsibility to stand up for him or her. हम ये तो बहुत आसानी से बोल देते हैं कि रोड पे जब एक्सीडेंट होता है तो आप देख के रिस्पॉन्ड कीजिए, उसको छोड़ के मत जाइए ये सोच के कि हम फंस जाएंगे। ये हम सब लोगों को सिखाते हैं, लेकिन हम अभी तक उस दौर पे नहीं आए कि हम लोगों को ये सिखाएं कि अगर एक महिला मार खा रही है तो आप उसको एड्रेस कीजिए वहां खड़े होकर, वहां से भागिए मत। The second thing, once you have acknowledged there is a responsibility on respond, is to how to respond. The most important aspect here is also to provide moral support. We kind of, you know, from a mental health perspective, we have not prioritized it as much as we should. But a woman or a man or a girl going through a situation of abuse, however bad, whatever form of abuse it may be and whatever space it may be, it's a process that immensely breaks someone down. It is a process that creates self-doubt. It is a process that creates anger, frustration, depression. And we must, as first responders, usually stand up to provide the moral support that we can provide human to human. The third, of course, to connect them to formal frameworks, which is to put them in touch with the local police thana. And then we have an entire first responder system in this country. We have a trained first responder system. We have a one-stop crisis center system, where a woman can actually go ahead and find shelter if she's in an unsafe space. The fourth is to follow up. I think we always forget the second F, which is to follow up. What happens is violence is usually, as I've seen and mostly, is not a one-time issue. It is an issue that occurs on a continuum. It is basically a culture that has been created in her life. It's important that if we are close to survivors of violence, that we continue that follow-up with them. And as friends and buddies, see through that circumstance in their lives until we take it really to the to its natural closure.
These actionable points that you have just discussed, they are, I think, it's so important for this to be out there. I really, really hope that it empowers every individual who is unfortunately enduring any kind of violence. I hope that it empowers people to take up for an individual who is experiencing any kind of violence. I really, really hope that it empowers our entire society as a whole to keep their eyes open, keep their ears open, and really take it up as their own business as well. If they know, as you said, that ki sirf unke ghar ki baat nahi hai, hum sabke ghar ki baat hai. If we even know remotely if someone is going through this, so we must really, really be the ones to step up and do something about it. So this battle to end violence against women cannot be won without empowering them to speak up for themselves. And how do you think we can encourage more and more women to stand up against violence, and even more importantly as well, to end the stigma around it?
You know, the battle that we're talking about to end violence against women cannot definitely be won without empowering women to speak up. But I must also recognize that it cannot be won without encouraging men and boys to take a stand as well. We have to realize that men and boys are a very, very equal part of the society. When we talk gender equality, we're basically not about talking about the swinging of the pendulum on one side. We're talking about, you know, an equilibrium. And usually it's very important that we work with men and boys to tell them that equality is not what I'm snatching from you. It is not me taking your space away from you. It is about me claiming my space. And it is about the redistribution of powers. If we were to really take this battle up, violence or, you know, gender discrimination of any sort, we will have to create these spaces, both for women and for men to identify themselves as advocates, and bring them really together. You know, sometimes we don't even know the worth when someone who's achieved, who looks like they've achieved in life, arrived in life, achieved their goals, when a woman like stands up and says, you know, I've gone through a horrible situation. This was my reality. I fought it. It makes so much of a difference to a woman who's watching that little video, to that woman who's watching and consuming that content, because it gives her the strength to know that this, you are not in this alone, number one. Number two, it gives us the affirmation that you have not called it upon yourselves. I've hardly seen a man come out and say, haan, ye main karta tha. I thought at a point in time that it was okay to beat up my wife and this was business as usual. I don't think like that anymore. Or I have changed. And we have to be able to capture these stories of evolution and put it out there as reality that people can reflect on. The third, of course, which is also a very important part and pillar of women speaking up, is women cannot speak up in a vacuum. So we must strengthen, like we say, the provision of essential services to survivors of violence that is essential in helping women find the confidence that I'm not just merely speaking up in a vacuum. I'm not speaking up, but I'm speaking to a system that is going to respond to the situation that I'm in. And I think that's a fundamental change in narrative. And I'm really glad that you're using your voice and the influence that you have among very young people to question, to challenge what they may have seen, they may have thought, and to be advocates for a world that doesn't just free women from its stereotypes, but also frees men and boys from their stereotypes. And this is a life that no one deserves to lead. We all deserve to be in a life where we want to be what we can. We can express ourselves how we can, both in terms of identity, sexuality, whatever. And I'm really glad that very young people like you have taken this up on them. It makes me very proud of you. This conversation has been a complete and absolute pleasure.
Thank you for starting this important conversation with me. And I really hope it gives power to every individual to open up about their unfortunate experience, and also others to help put an end to violence against women. Please remember that you are never alone. We're always here to listen to you, support you, and help you feel safe.